Good morning, church family. Good to be back here in the house of the Lord with my Middleton church family. I've missed you guys. Happy New Year. And we're a little lighter today. I know my family, I got a couple colds running in my family today, so they decided to stay home. So there's some of that going around still too, isn't there? Just colds. But I am happy to be here, and I've really been excited about this message today. Thank you for the children's story. Yeah, Missouri River. I grew up real close to the Missouri River. That's exactly my old stomping ground. That's a long river, but it's a privilege to come worship today. These verses spoke to me this week. The Lord was speaking to me in a way to share this message of you are my witnesses, ye are my witnesses. And in this verse we read, thank you, Daniel, for reading today, you are my witnesses, Isaiah 43:10 says, you are my witnesses, says the Lord, and my servants whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, nor shall there be after me. Goes on to say, I am the Lord, and besides me there is no Savior. I have declared and saved, I have proclaimed, and there was no foreign God among you. Therefore, you are my witnesses, says the Lord, that I am the God. He is our God. He is our Savior. Let us pray. Father God, Lord, we praise you today. Thank you for being with us in music and in prayer and in our worship. Lord, I again invite your spirit here now that these may not be my words, but your words, Lord. Speak to us now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. As I was driving up from Missouri 27, 28 years ago to go to Minnesota, I had a calf, a baby calf to not deliver as in being born, but to deliver to someone who had purchased it. We had a dairy farm in Missouri, and somebody had bought a calf of ours that I needed to deliver to Minnesota. And I was driving in my pickup, and the calf was in the back, and I had a friend with me for this long trip. And we stopped at a restaurant. We were just outside of Minneapolis at this point. Stopped at a restaurant. We're sitting by the window. I can picture it. This is about 93, 94, maybe, something like that, a long time ago. And there's this window, and we're just sitting there looking out the window, and we see a car pull in the parking lot. At the same time, we see this motorcycle just flying through the parking lot. The motorcycle T-bones the car. The car stops. The motorcycle comes to a stop. The rider of the motorcycle does a flip over the car and sticks the landing. We look at each other. Did you just see what I saw? Yeah, I did. This guy sticks the landing, and of course the motorcycle, it comes, I mean, he was flying through the parking lot. It just kind of explodes in little pieces, and the person that pulled into the parking lot stunned and comes to a stop. So we go out to see if the guy's all right. We don't know who else saw this. And at first, you know what happens when you're in an accident? I've seen this many times, actually. Yeah, I'm fine. And then the hormones, the different adrenaline. Then you go into shock, right? They go into shock. All of a sudden, the guy, now he's laying down, and he's shaking. And so we call 911, and the ambulance come, police come. And they, what do they say? They said, what did you see? What did you witness, right? What happened here? And so we're obligated, but we want to do that, to say what we saw, our point of view. We tell them, here's what we saw. And they want to know whose fault it is, and I don't know, I'll let you figure that out, but here's what we saw. And so we were witnesses. So a witness has to have seen or experienced it firsthand. Firsthand experience, what they saw, what they heard, the conversations that we had. So that's what's going on in these first verses of Isaiah 43. First, we must, to be a witness, we must have experienced it for ourselves. We must have experienced the work of the Lord, the Holy Spirit moving, what Jesus has done in our hearts. We must have experienced it. And when you look at these verses, Isaiah 42, we go back in there, it's pretty much Israel has walked away, right? They're worshiping idols. They've walked away from the Lord. And yet the Lord, in his love, is redeeming them. In fact, the headline of Isaiah 43, for me, it says in my Bible, the Redeemer of Israel. And he goes through these verses saying, yeah, basically, you've walked away from me. You've sinned against me. You've followed other gods. But he goes on to say in verse 1, 43, but now thus says the Lord who created you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, the Lord is saying through Isaiah. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. And when you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I gave Egypt for your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in your place. Verse 4, he says, since you were precious in my sight, you have been honored, and I have loved you. Therefore, I will give men for you and people for your life. Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your descendants from the east and gather them from the west. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, don't keep them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I have created for my glory, I have formed him. Yes, I have made him. God is proclaiming that he is creator. He is redeemer. He is all in all, and I've done this for you. Yes, you've walked away from me, he's saying, but I have redeemed you. You are mine. What can man do to you? Do not worry. Do not be afraid. I am your God. Believe in me. So they've got this testimony now. They've witnessed firsthand that he does love them. He is love. God is love. And now he says, and then he goes on to say, you are my witnesses to this. You are my witnesses. So first, we must have witnessed and experienced something ourselves before we can be a witness. And then once we've witnessed it, if we've witnessed an accident, we are obligated to go tell the story. Here's what happened, right? From our point of view. Here's what we saw from our point of view, right? Because it's the right thing to do. And each of us has a different point of view. You look at the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. They have their different point of view of who God is. They don't collide, coincide of God is love and the stories within those Gospels, but they've each got their different point of view. You look at Peter, he's got his point of view. 2 Peter 1, 16 through 18 says, for we do not follow cunningly devised fables when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honor and glory when such a voice came to him from the excellent glory. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And we heard this voice. So they are eyewitnesses. He says, we heard this voice which came from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. So Peter is giving his point of view, saying this isn't a devised fable. This isn't some made up story that sounds kind of cool. This is what happened. We were witnesses to it. This is what we heard. John has his own perspective here in 1 John chapter 1, the very first four verses of 1 John 1, says that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, and which we have looked upon and our hands have handled concerning the word of life. John's saying we are witnesses to this. What we have heard, what we've seen, what we've looked upon, what we've handled, we are witnesses. And now he says the next words, and now we declare to you. Here's what we've witnessed. Now we're telling you that eternal life, which was with the Father and manifested to us, that which we have seen and heard, we declare to you that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write to you that your joy may be full. We're telling you this. We heard it. We saw it for ourselves. We handled it. We experienced this. And now we're telling you, Because we want you to have this peace. We want you to have this joy. We want your joy to be full. That's why. We don't want to keep this to ourselves. We're telling you. There's this story of a man in India, northeastern India. I remember reading one time that he, back when this was written, when I read this, they called him deaf and dumb. He was a mute, and I guess he didn't know sign language, but he would make motions and movements to communicate what he needed to communicate. And he was a believer in Christ. He loved the Lord, and he would be bold because he couldn't use words. People knew him around town. And when a person, when somebody was smoking a cigarette, he walked up to him, took the cigarette out, and threw it. He didn't know the guy. But he could get away with it. They knew who he was. They knew this is how he communicated. And he would communicate through his words and actions that there is a God that loves you. He wants you to be healthy. And I don't know how he did his hand motions, but he would get his point across by being bold in his way, pulling the cigarette out and saying, God loves you. God is there for you. And he wants you to be healthy. He wants you to give your heart to him. See, he could get away. I couldn't get away. You and I might get punched in the face for that. But but we all communicate differently. And there's some people that I can reach. Maybe you can't. But I guarantee there's a lot of people that you can reach that I can't. I don't have the experience in the relationship that you have. And neither do you and I. And that's why God needs all of his people to be his witnesses. We each have our own different point of view, our own perspective. But in the middle of that, the center is Jesus. In the center of that is his love and God's love for us, calling us to come back to him, like these verses in Isaiah 43. Friends, we have heard the good news. If we have heard the good news, if we've tasted and seen that the Lord is good for ourselves, right? If we have felt the Holy Spirit working in our heart, if he has changed our heart from the old person we used to be into the new creation, if we have witnessed this, if we have peace that passes all understanding that we didn't have before, if we have the wonderful gift of salvation and we have this joy. I remember when I first was in my early 20s, was learning the Bible and learning these truths, how I went from an angry young man into finding peace. I would find peace in ways that I never found before. And once we have that in our heart, I couldn't help but share it. I wanted everybody to know this. There is truth. There is love in God's word. And have you seen this? Have you seen this truth? Because up until then, I'd kind of been raised in a church occasionally. But when I read the truth, when I witnessed him for myself, when I had my own experience with the Lord, I couldn't help but tell anybody I knew. Everybody I knew, sharing it with my family and my friends. I wasn't as bold to pull a cigarette out of a mouth, but I was pretty bold. I was on fire for the Lord, and he's lit that fire for me. And when we have that, nothing can hold us back. We don't tell the story of Jesus or witness because we feel obligated. Well, it's the right thing to do. It's because it's in us, and it's just going to come out. We can't keep it from coming out. I'm so glad this church loves to share the good news of Jesus. I'm so glad this church loves to do the things it's doing. When I read, I was going to mention this anyway, and I looked through the bulletin today, this morning, just a while ago. And on that last page on the inside, it says, please remember to mark envelopes for. And when we had board meeting the other night, we talked about how, wow, what are the big three things we spent money on this last year as a church? Evangelism. Right? Evangelism. So the first one, Evangelism Fund for April Prophecy Weekend. We're having another prophecy weekend coming up. It's called the Serpentine Prophecy. It's a four-night thing that we're doing. So this time, we're doing four nights, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. We're going to invite the whole community. We're going to send out all the invitations and the announcements. And then from there, after that fourth night, it's more of the personal relationships. It's meeting with people and Bible study, more personal at that point. So we have personal evangelism. We've got the Literature Fund for the Great Controversy is one of our big fundraisers that we've spent money on and that we've raised money as a church, and I'm so excited about this. I'm so excited about what God's doing because there is a family sitting here today that part of their witness, part of their story is, and they came, I'm talking about Michelle and Robert here, they came to the Revelation series, but did you know, what's interesting is, back how long, a year ago? Last year, just this last year, They were in a home. It was her sister-in-law. And the sister-in-law lives near here in the Treasure Valley and said, I got this book. I'm probably going to throw it away. It's called The Great Controversy. And they said, I don't know why she even brought it up. Why do you bring up a book that you're just going to throw away? But for some reason, she did. Said, I'm just going to throw this away. I just got this book in the mail. Well, Michelle said, well, I'll read it. So this is last summer, before she had ever come here. They had watched the Days of Noah, I think, and they had been studying, founding the truths of the Sabbath. But she said, well, I'll read it. Read The Great Controversy. They get mailers in the mail for this meeting's coming up. God is working in their lives in so many different angles that it's just obvious to them that they need to come to the series. They come to the series. I'm meeting with them one night, maybe halfway through the series. We're sitting in the library talking. And we're talking about Ellen White. We're talking, and maybe it must have been maybe towards the end then. We're talking about prophecy and we're talking about, I said, well, you said you read one of her books. That was The Great Controversy. And she said, she wrote that book? I didn't know that. Yeah, so God was working in this way. So we think about how he's working in so many ways. Part of it is our witness, but I mean, it's the work of the Holy Spirit, right? Who could coordinate all that? Who could coordinate that? So we have this great controversies, literature, evangelism. And then we have the media and AV updates that we've done in here. And it's all about getting the word out. It's all about being witnesses. As a church, we've done some of that. And the Lord has led here in getting the word and the truth out of Jesus and his love for us. But there's also the part of personal evangelism, right? Just as important, maybe even more important, is the personal evangelism. Zechariah 8:16 says, these are the things you shall do. Speak each man the truth to his neighbor. And then Paul writes in Ephesians 4:25, let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Speaking truth to our neighbors. Ooh, are we speaking truth to our neighbors? One of my favorite stories in the Bible is the demon-possessed, the two demon-possessed men. We find it in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, in those three Gospels, about the demon-possessed men. And in two of them, it says a demon-possessed man, and one of them, it says two of them. We're talking about the same location, the same things happened. So in this one, we focus on the two. In Mark 5, 18, 20, we see that Jesus gets out of the boat, and he's in the Gadarenes, right? Decapolis. He's there, and there's these men, they're in chains and living in the caves, and they're cutting themselves with rocks. And the Bible says they're screaming day and night. They're hollering and they're naked and just filled with demons. And they run up to him and say, what would you have to do with us? He says, what is your name? We are legion, for we are many, many demons. And they say, you know, don't cast us out into the abyss. You know the story, cast us into the swine. And so he does so, the swine go off the edge of the cliff, drown and die, and this guy is free. These men are free, and they're at Jesus' feet just thanking him for setting him free. He hasn't preached a sermon. He hasn't taught them all the ways of the Bible. He's just set them free, and that's the experience that we each have. And when he got into the boat, when Jesus got in the boat, he who had been demon-possessed begged him that he might be with him. Once we experience Jesus, we want more Jesus, right? Once we experience the work of the Holy Spirit, we can't hold back. We want more of him. And that's all. They just wanted to be with their Savior at this point, the one that had set him free. And what does he say? Yeah, come on. No, he did not permit them, but said to them, go to your friends. Tell them what great things the Lord has done for you and how he has had compassion on you. And Jesus departed. And the two demon-possessed, they departed and began to proclaim in Decapolis all that Jesus had done for them, and all marveled at what he had done. There is there's a page I want to read to you from The Great Controversy. In the Desire of Ages, in page 340, talks about this. And I love what she writes here in Desire of Ages, page 340. Talking about the demon-possessed men. Here was a work for them to do after Jesus sends them out to go tell what he had done. To go to a heathen home and tell of the blessing they had received from Jesus. It was hard for them to be separated from the Savior. Great difficulties were sure to beset them in association with their heathen countrymen, and their long isolation from society seemed to have disqualified them for the work. He had indicated that he had indicated, but as soon as Jesus pointed out their duty, they were ready to obey. Not only did they tell their own households and neighbors about Jesus, but they went throughout Decapolis, everywhere declaring his power to save and describing how he had freed them from the demons. In doing this work, they would receive a greater blessing than if merely benefit to themselves they had remained in his presence. It is in working to spread the good news of salvation that we are brought nearer to the Savior. Can you say amen? Amen. We are brought nearer to him by telling the good news of salvation. The two restored demoniacs were the first missionaries whom Christ sent to preach the gospel to the region of Decapolis. For a few moments only, these men had been privileged to hear the teachings of Christ. Not one sermon from his lips had ever fallen upon their ears. They could not instruct the people as the disciples who had been daily with Christ were able to do, but they bore in their own person the evidence that Jesus was the Messiah. They could tell what they knew, what they themselves had seen and heard and felt of the power of Christ. This is what everyone can do whose heart has been touched by the grace of God. John, the beloved disciple, wrote, "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon with our hands, and have handled of the word of life, that which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you." As witnesses for Christ, we are to tell what we know from our perspective, right? What we know, what we ourselves have heard and felt. If we have been following Jesus step by step, we shall have something right to the point to tell concerning the way in which he had led us. We can tell how we have tested his promise and found the promise true. We can bear witness to what we have known of the grace of Christ. This is the witness of which our Lord calls, for want of which the world is perishing. Though the people of Gergesa had not received Jesus, he did not leave them to the darkness which they had chosen. When they bade him depart from them, they had not heard his words. They were ignorant of that which was they were rejecting. Therefore, he again sent light to them and by those to whom they would not refuse to listen. Do you want to be closer to Jesus in 2022? Then we tell others about him. The way to get closer to him, yes, we need to draw nearer to him, but the way to get even closer is by spreading that good news to others, telling others about his love for us. The more we give, you see, the more we have. As a kid, I grew up going to this Methodist church, and on Christmas Eve, we would have a Christmas Eve service. And on the Christmas Eve service, there would be up front, the house was packed on Easter and Christmas. And Christmas Eve, everybody's there. There's like maybe 250 people there. And the pastor up front would have a candle. And we'd all have our own candles with a little paper thing, a little candle. And he would light one candle to somebody in the front, and it would just go around and spread, and we'd sing Silent Night or something like that, I think. And as it spread, what I noticed is when we share the candle with somebody beside us, when the two are together, it burns a little brighter. And we're not diminishing our own light by doing that, and we're giving off new light. And the next person, their light burns just as bright as my candle did, and yet I'm not diminished in the light that I have. You see, as Christians, the light of our witness for Jesus never burns out. It can be multiplied. It adds to. When we're together, there's a bigger flame. It doesn't diminish my experience with Christ by sharing it with others. There is power in witnessing for the Lord. You might get shut down from time to time, but even Jesus got shut down, right? In John chapter 3, when Nicodemus was saying, "What, you got to be born again? What is this?" And he's not quite following, and he's talking to the right? The ruler of the Jews, he's called, the Pharisee Nicodemus. Jesus answered, said to him, "Are you the teacher of Israel and don't know these things? Most assuredly, I say to you, we speak that we what we know and testify what we have seen, and you do not receive our witness." Sometimes they're not going to receive your witness, right? That's just what happens, right? We might get shut down. But we need to remember, right? And Jesus said, knock the dust off your boots and move on. All we're called to do is to be your witnesses. That's all he says here in this verse. You are my witnesses. He doesn't say you are the one that convict hearts. He doesn't say that. The work of the Holy Spirit does the heart convicting. He says, you are my witnesses. Move on. Go to the next. And it's the power of the Holy Spirit that works. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. It says, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. You shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, in all Judea, Samaria, and to the end of the earth. We are called to be witnesses, and the power of the Holy Spirit is upon us. And then later in Acts chapter 18, now the Lord spoke to Paul in the night by a vision. It says, do not be afraid, but speak, and do not keep silent, for I am with you. No one else will attack you or hurt you. He's talking, because he's talking to Corinth at this time. He's preaching in Corinth. This is a pretty rough neighborhood he's in preaching to. He's like, I'm going to be with you. I've got your back. And we need to be bold. Titus 2:15 says, speak these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority, let no one despise you. It's the power of the Holy Spirit. We should be bold and unashamed. Paul had another time where he was speaking to King Agrippa in Acts chapter 26. The king, Agrippa. And he's telling him, he's given his testimony of everything that happened to him, because he's got his own testimony. He's sharing everything. And Agrippa says, well, you almost persuade me to be a Christian with this testimony. And he says, then Paul says in verse 29, I would to God that not only you, but also all who hear me today might become both almost and altogether such as I am, except for the chains. Except for the chains. He's bold. He's talking to the king. He wants to tell the good news to whoever will listen, right? Friends, it's time for us to be bold for Jesus. This court decision, this Supreme Court decision, yes, it is a victory, but time's running short. I praise God for that decision. We've got more time, more freedom. Freedom's already eroding, but we've got time to tell the good news of Jesus. He's got a message for us to give. We see what he's done for us, that he's been our redeemer. He's our creator. He's our love. He's always with us and never leaves us. And so we've got a witness to give. It's time to be a witness while we still can. It's time to be a witness now while we still have our freedoms. God needs witnesses today. David Livingstone, maybe you've heard of him. He was a pioneer missionary in Africa, one of the most well-known missionaries ever. And he received a letter saying, have you found a good road to where you are? This is from these other possible missionaries coming to join him. They send him a letter. Have you found a good road to where you are? If so, he says, we will come to meet you and join you. To which Livingstone replied, if you have men who will only come if there's a good road, I don't want you. I don't want you. If you're only going to come if it's easy, if it's paid for you, and it's all laid out, and there's no worries, you're not the guys I want. He said, I want one men that will come if there's no road at all. Friends, we still have a good road. We've got plenty of Bibles. We've got funding. The Lord has blessed us. We've got many avenues to which to share the good news. It's our opportunity, it's our privilege, obligation, yeah, but privilege to share this with others now. There is a mission field right here in Southwest Idaho. There's a mission field in your neighborhood. There's a mission field at your workplace. I remember when I was a new Christian, and I don't pray it, but I would pray it every morning. Lord, give me one person to tell this to talk to about Jesus. And you know, that's a prayer that is almost always answered. when I started praying that every morning, give me somebody this morning, Lord, to talk to about God and tell the good news of Jesus, almost every day there would be somebody. I was looking for it too at that time. I was very, I was focused on it. It almost came to me. Preacher runs out of words sometimes. Intentional. Somebody said it. Intentional. Very intentional. And he would answer that prayer. He would give me somebody. It maybe not wouldn't be a whole complete Bible study sitting down, but somebody to tell the good news, Jesus loves you. Somebody that brightened their day up. He loves those kinds of prayers. There's a young man in one of our churches. He's in a wheelchair, and he can kind of use his fingers. He can't speak, but he has an email address. And he's a regular attender at one of our churches, and I try to give him a hug, and how are you? He can't communicate. He's got his helper there with him. But he handed me a card one day. And he said, I want you through. He can kind of say where I couldn't understand him, but she's been around him long enough, she can understand him. So he wants you to email him. I said, okay. And on here was his email address. And as I sat down at my desk, I put it in my pocket, didn't think about it. And then if it was that night or the next day, I said, oh, yeah, I wanted to email him. So I pull it out, and then I looked at the card a little better. It says, on the one side, it says, set your minds on things above, not on earthly things, Colossians 3:2. You flip it over, and it says, Jesus is coming soon, get ready. And it's got a website, amazingfacts.org, with love, and it's got his name and his email address. He's being a witness right there. His only way to communicate. And so I email him, and he can actually, I don't know how long, he can kind of use his fingers, but it's the most beautiful email. I mean, it's just full of love, and it's full of edification, his love for the Lord, and appreciate you as a pastor, saying all these things that must be inside of his head that he couldn't communicate to me there. He communicated through the email, the most coherent, beautiful email. And so now I see him occasionally and give each other a hug, and it's kind of a brief, awkward conversation, but I said, I'll email you again. And so we email, and he passes these cards out to people he knows and people he doesn't know. And he makes sure that they know Jesus is coming soon. Get ready. And to set your minds on things above. He's a witness for the Lord in that wheelchair. What am I complaining about? What am I doing? He's out here doing it. He's doing the work of the Lord. He's answering that call. You are my witnesses. You are my witnesses. I want to give you, in this year, I want to give you a challenge. What if you prayed every morning, who can I tell about Jesus today? What if you thought in your mind today, right now, somebody that you would like to tell? Maybe you've got somebody in mind to tell about Jesus, somebody at work or a family member, maybe that's straight away, and just show your love to them. It doesn't have to be the awkward conversation. It could just be the simple thing, right? Jesus loves you. It could be anywhere in between where you say, well, I'm not good with words. Well, you know what? This young man, he didn't have any words, but he had the right words. I challenge you to pray that prayer. Who can I reach for Christ today? Lord, give me somebody. Put somebody in my way that maybe I could just, maybe it's that easy. Have a card and you're doing as you go by, or a neighbor or something, give them a card. I don't know, or a card in the mail. But who could you reach for the Lord this year? What if we all had that goal, reaching somebody for the Lord to know Christ as their Savior in this year, 2022? We've got opportunities. There's opportunities all around us. The road is clear right now. It's an easy road, right? Doesn't have to be bushwhacked. It's already set before us. Who is the person that God has put in your life to share the good news with? You are my witnesses, he says. You are my witnesses. Let us pray. Father God, Lord, thank you so much for redeeming us, for calling us to be your own child. Lord, thank you for the love of Jesus, that we are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ and not of works. Lord, you are love, and we just praise you and thank you today. Put in our hearts this challenge, Lord, to put somebody in front of our lives to share the good news with. Lord, please, our days are numbered here. Each one, tomorrow's not guaranteed for any of us, and neither are our loved ones or those that we pass on the street. What a horrific thing could be that if we want to share and something happens to the person and then we didn't share. Lord, give us one person today to share the good news with. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for Jesus who makes it all possible. In his name we pray. Amen. Amen.